just as well not exist.
Thank you. Thank you. here whom you must meet. Not Asher Rossover. Won't you ask her to dance? She's a girl of rare quality.
Well, where is she, your young friend? Come on, come on, come on, hey ha! Allow me to introduce you to my daughter. I already have the pleasure of her acquaintance. If the Countess still remembers me.
There's someone that I could easily fall in love with. Elaine, hey!
Well, my dear, if you were to ask me nicely, I'd see what I could arrange.
Elaine, what an adorable sister you are.
Come on, hey ha! And was your ditzy friend Matryosha pleased with her present?
She should be.
Thank you. Are you enjoying yourself, Natasha?
I was never so happy in all my life before.
Come and visit us, Prince, on Sunday. She goes first to her cousin, and then goes and speaks to that other lady afterwards. Then I know that she will be my wife. What strange, nonsensical ideas sometimes come into our heads. She has gone to her cousin to the princess.
Oh, how
my dear princess, I've brought my little daughter here to see you.
I've already heard so much about you. I'm really glad.
How glad I am that you two should have met at last. Now, if you'll allow me, princess, I'll leave Natasha in your hands for a brief quarter of an hour, while I go and pay my respects to Madame Aprosimova. Then I'll come straight back here for her.
Don't be afraid of me,
thank you. My fate lies in your hands, either to be loved by Here's your help.
car. Come on, my boys, let's go.
This car's got here, but not in this way.
What? And who's lost he got?
He's a witness. Joseph! Ah, where's the door? Joseph! A quiet time at your number, Vierna. And ask the whole door. Come rushing out for dead than alive, just in what she was wearing. But then if there's the slightest hold up, there'll be tears, and die, and mother. And before you know it, she'll be frozen and wandering up home. So you wrap her in a fur right away, and carry her off to the sledge yourself. But first, I told you clearly the sable cloak. Hey, Russia, bring the sable cloak.
Vera, I don't mind, I don't mind. I don't mind. You can't take it.
Oh, your brother, oh, you'll be drowned! Oh, A visitor!
I told you that I would see no one!
Oh, God, your healer, it's the super!
Fair super! Ask him in! He's just the man I need at a moment like this! He's a mortal-minded and a Is it true that he's married?
Whether it's true or not should make no difference to you now.
You mean so, Reuben? You mean that he's not married?
Yes, he's married.
Oh,
anywhere away from this life I lead. Leave behind this unnecessary luxury. If it has anybody for me at all, it lies in the pleasure I would have in turning my back on all this useless splendor. Ah, of equality and love. I have sought the answer in worldly pleasures. I've sought for it in romantic love, in love for a thrush or a swallow.
And that's the end of part one of War and Peace by Sergei Prokofiev in this historic production which opened the Sydney Opera House in 1973. Edward Downes, who incidentally wrote the English text we're hearing, conducted the Elizabethan Trust Sydney Orchestra and the Australian Opera Chorus. After the comparative peace of the first half, part two of the opera brings us to the brink of war as the Russian army prepares for the Battle of Borodino.
Destroy the Polish communications, but I have my head, I take a whirlwind, finish the sweet of God, Thank you. simple. The whole thing was cruelly simple and sordid.
Be careful, Soup. If only he doesn't talk about Natasha.
Ah, you're here. And what would that bring you here?
I came here, well, really, to see what it felt like being a madman.
I see. And all those ideals that you face and have, dreams of a universal brotherhood, how can you reconcile them with war? What would you do?
Extended over a wider area.
Yeah, Lord.
Just to listen to those idiotic German generals.
The main aim of war is no matter how to weaken the enemy. By then, it is obvious he can't be expected to worry much about private individuals.
Yeah, Lord. Over a wider area.
A wider area. My father.
To come here to teach us the way to fight.
Famous teachers indeed.
Your Excellency, the regiment is drawn up beyond the mound.
But I will tell you this, that whatever may happen, we shall win the battle tomorrow. Just ask my army, he knows that we're going to win. But those Germans realize we shall be fighting to save our own Russian land. And we shall win.
Thank you. join in the brotherly life. To enter in with my heart beat. To be imbued with a simple noble spirit. A simple and strong, and they would rather do things than talk of them. Words that are spoken as silver, but unspoken, they are golden. They are weight of battle calmly, for no man can be the master of his fate, so long as he's still afraid of dying. But he who conquers is he of mine, and masters himself, he shall inherit.
Oh, my God.
I'm afraid that I'm no longer suitable for staff work.
I'm sorry, but I really need you.
The thing is this, I've got used to my man. I've grown fond of them too. And it seems that they have grown fond of me as well.
I understand. And you're right. I can always find advisers. I'm surrounded by advisers. This army could be different. My son, God bless you. You must go your own way, the way you've chosen, the way of honor. Well, goodbye. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you.
but the Red Vision forward.
Your Majesty, if I may make so bold, might I suggest a little luncheon now? I trust I may already congratulate Your Majesty on a victory. What reason on earth could possibly prevent you from taking a lunch now?
For God's sake, leave me.
But why is His Majesty so gloomy? For surely we have won a victory.
Won a victory? We just escaped being defeated. The slightest change of fortune and all would have been lost. It's not, but something's changed. It's all, but something's changed from how it was in former times. After I had given a few orders, my marshals would gallop up, their faces alight with joy, with a list of our trophies, thousands of prisoners, cannon and standard. But now it all seems different. There's something strange about the way we fight. The same soldiers, the same commanders, and I too am the same, though I far more feel now. So what's the reason?
Capital to the enemy.
still gone hawking, and one day we'll finally made up from our land. But if we should lose that army, then goodbye, both to Moscow and to like to have your opinions.
If we decide to stand and fight for Moscow, only one result seems possible: we'll be defeated. Sad though the thought may be of abandoning the capital, regretfully, I say we must retreat.
Our position a far more modern than the enemy's. But knowing what Moscow means to our people, I propose that we stay here and fight in its defense. It is not hard to foresee what the effect will be in foreign courts the moment that they hear that Moscow has been occupied. I would suggest that during the night we concentrate our forces on the left. Then when daylight comes we could launch an attack upon the center where the French are weak.
It would be far too dangerous to make such a move with the enemy so near that land. Besides, do not forget that our losses were enormous,
those of the enemy.
And no less than ours.
If we decide to fight, we should attack the French rather than defend in indefensible positions. Russia is more than Moscow. She'll
That's why we must stand out, no matter what else is lost. And so I believe that Moscow should be abandoned without a battle. I only speak as a soldier, and now we must await our commander. Only he can decide.
Decision and accept responsibility. I have heard what you have had to say to me. I believe that the enemy, by occupying us, will only hasting his own destruction. So I along the road, Triassan. Gentlemen, that will be all.
She will never know. Thank you. have set their town on fire themselves. What resolution! What
the grass, the sunlight, oh,
peace go on existing while I did not exist. Oh, my country, golden Moscow, my love, must I forever say farewell? Must I
has no more meaning now, because I love you.
Behind us lies certain destruction.
Thank you.